The weight gain in the NICU always lags behind the fetal weight gain. You can see here, these are the light gray boxes are the weight gain which happens in the NICU. This weight gain is actually lagging behind the fetal weight gain. And here in this graph also, you can see the dotted, the dashed lines indicates the weight gain in the neonatal period, which is actually below the central charts of the thing, intrauterine growth charts. So the actual scenario, the weight gain will always be less compared to the fetal weight gain. So why nutrition is so important? Nutrition is important because every 1 gram per kg per day of protein intake, increase in protein intake during the neonatal period, increases the mental developmental index by 8.2 points. And every 10 kilocalorie per kg per day of energy increase, increases again the mental developmental index by 4.6 points. So nutrition, aggressive nutrition, good nutrition is directly related to the better neurodevelopmental outcome. You can see here in this graph, the weight gain is inversely proportional to the neurodevelopmental impairment. You can see here the babies who gain somewhere around on average 20 gram per kg per day, the neurodevelopmental impairment is less compared to the babies who gain only 12 gram per kg per day. Same is with the cerebral palsy. As the weight gain per kg per day increases during the neonatal period, the incidence of CP also decreases. So having known the importance of aggressive nutrition in a neonatal period, we should consider that every preterm birth should be considered as a nutritional emergency, and aggressive nutrition should be the target for us when we treat these babies. So this is the first question for poll. What is the gestational age cutoff for starting total parenteral nutrition from birth in all the babies? Is it less than 28 weeks, less than 31 weeks, less than 34 weeks, or less than 36 weeks?
It would be less than 31 weeks.
Okay. So poll is not opening here. Anyhow, I'll skip that. So this is the latest guidelines from the NICE from 2020. So according to them, the indications of total parenteral nutrition are, if the baby's gestational age is less than 31 weeks, then one has to start total parenteral nutrition in all the babies, in all the neonates. If the gestational age is more than 31 weeks, then one can start PPN if you're not able to start the enteral feeds in the first 72 hours after birth, or if the patient baby is having any congenital gut disorder such as any intestinal obstruction or malnutrition or any other problem, or in the cases of critical illness such as sepsis. So this is the NICE guideline, which states that in all babies less than 31 weeks, you should start TPN. If the baby was previously on enteral feeds and you had to stop the enteral feeds for any other reason, you have to start TPN if you are unlikely to restart the enteral feeds in 48 hours in preterm babies, and if you are unlikely to restart the feeds, unlikely to restart feeds in next 72 hours in term babies. So if the baby was previously on enteral feeds and if you have kept him NPO for any other reason, then in preterm babies, if you're unlikely to restart in 48 hours, then you have to start TPN. And in term babies, it is 72 hours. This is also according to the latest NICE guidelines. So having known the importance, if you see the trend among the neonatologists over the last few years, there is a positive trend over the last few years for starting the TPN from day one. You can see here in the day one, from 2010 to 2013, the most of the neonatologists are starting the TPN from day one, and most of them by day two. So this is a very good sign that the positive trend. So even though the data is quite old, from 2010 to 2013, but the trend is a good sign. So when we should start the TPN? TPN should be started as soon as possible after the birth. Maximum is within 8 hours of birth. How to administer TPN? Ideally, a central venous catheter is the preferred mode to give the TPN, total parenteral nutrition. But central venous catheter is essential, but it is not absolutely necessary. You can also give total parenteral nutrition through peripheral venous access. You can use the peripheral venous access if there is a delay in starting parenteral nutrition, especially if you are if there is no skilled person in placing a central line or a PICC line. And if you are anticipating TPN for a very short term, that is for less than 5 days, then you can use a peripheral line. And if the central venous access is impractical for any reason, in these three conditions, you can use the peripheral venous access. Surgical insertion of central venous catheter should be considered to give TPN, especially most commonly if the patient is having a short bowel syndrome, where you expect long-term parenteral nutrition like 3 to 4 weeks. then surgical insertion of central venous catheter is indicated. Or if non-surgical insertion is not possible, if you are not able to place a PICC line or a central line, then venous cut down of a central line is preferred. So in those two conditions, surgical insertion is preferred. So coming to the individual components of TPN, first is energy. This is the approximate protein, carbohydrate, and the fat requirement in a preterm in a neonate. Protein requirement is somewhere around 10 to 15% of total calories. Fat requirement should be somewhere around 30 to 40%, and carbohydrate requirement should be somewhere around 50 to 60% of the total calorie intake. So let us see, if you give excessive energy or inadequate energy, what happens? If you give excessive energy to a neonate, then it may result in hyperglycemia, and hyperglycemia again increases the risk of infection. It may cause cholestatic liver disease, abnormal metabolic programming, and increasing in incidence of diabetes, hypertriglyceridemia, and atherosclerosis in the later age group. And it may also result in excessive fat deposition and excessive generation of the free fatty acids. If you give inadequate energy, then it may result in impaired growth. We already discussed that impaired growth is one of the important factor for abnormal neurodevelopment, and it also increases the risk of serious morbidity and mortality. So this is the estimated energy requirement in a preterm baby. Approximately around 40 to 60 kilocalorie per kg per day is required for resting metabolic rate, that is for the normal tissue function. Around 5 kilocalorie per kg per day is required for normal activity of a preterm baby and to maintain the temperature. Another 15 kilocalorie per kg per day is required for tissue synthesis, that is for the growth. And another 20 to 30 kilocalorie per kg per day of energy is stored in the body, and 15 kilocalorie per kg per day of energy is excreted in the form of stools. So total requirement in a preterm is somewhere around 90 to 120 kilocalorie per kg per day. Enteral nutrition, the calorie requirement will be slightly more compared to the parenteral nutrition, somewhere around 30 kilocalorie per kg per day more. So based on this chart, both the NICE guidelines and ESPEN guidelines recommend energy in 30 to 60 kilocalorie per day in the first few days, that is in the first 4 days, and NICE guidelines recommend to increase the energy to 75 kilocalorie per kg per day. ESPEN guidelines also recommend to start somewhere around 45 to 55 kilocalorie per kg per day, and to increase to 90 to 120 kilocalorie per kg per day. Both the guidelines recommend to increase to somewhere around 100 to 120 kilocalorie per kg per day once the baby is stabilized on TPN. ESPEN guidelines recommend to aim a weight gain of around 17 to 20 gram per kg per day. So in summary, on day one, you have to aim an energy requirement of somewhere around 50 kilocalorie per kg per day, and gradually increase the energy requirement so to somewhere around 100 kilocalorie per kg per day by day three. Now, coming to another important component in TPN, that is glucose, carbohydrate. You can see here, this is the normal umbilical glucose uptake in different mammals, in sheep, cow, and horse, and human. In human fetus, the fetus requires around 5 milligram per kg per minute of glucose infusion in the intrauterine life. And if you see in this graph, the glucose concentration in the normal fetus will be, if it is more than 54 milligram per deciliter, that is if it is more than 3 millimole per liter, then this results in a normal fetal growth rate. The fetuses which grow normally in the in utero period, their glucose concentration will be somewhere more than 54 milligram per deciliter, and that means these babies will gain a weight of around 17 to 20 gram per kg per day in the in utero life. So we can take the same thing to our preterm babies which we are treating. So based on this evidence, both the guidelines recommend a glucose requirement of somewhere around 4 to 6 in the first 4 days, that is GAR of 4 to 6. And in the maintenance phase, you can gradually increase the glucose infusion rate to somewhere between 6.25 to 11 milligram per kg per minute. This is according to the NICE guidelines. ESPEGAN guidelines also gives similar recommendation. In a preterm babies, ESPEGAN recommends to start glucose infusion rate somewhere between 4 to 8 and to gradually increase the glucose requirement to 8 to 10 milligram per kg per minute from day 2 onwards to reach a maximum up to 12. One can reach up to 8 to 10. In a term baby, ESPEGAN recommends the glucose infusion rate should be somewhere between 2 to 5. And gradually it should be increased to reach a target of 10 milligram per kg per minute. So based on these two guidelines, for our settings, we can recommend that you can start with glucose infusion rate of somewhere between 4 to 6 milligram per kg per minute gradually increase the glucose infusion rate by 2 milligram per kg per minute and maintain a glucose infusion rate of 8 to 10 milligram per kg per minute. Espegan recommends that measurement of blood glucose should ideally be done by blood gas analyzers because the sensitivity of the blood gas analyzers is better compared to the routine glucose stick monitoring. The glucose stick monitoring has a lot of false positive and false negative results. So they recommend that blood gas analyzers should be used for estimation of blood glucose, but this may not be practical in our settings to do blood gas too frequently. Whenever there is an opportunity to do a blood gas, at the same time, one should see the blood glucose level in the blood gas. And when you're giving TPN, you have to avoid blood sugar more than 145. This is also a strong recommendation. And if the baby has repeated glucose values more than 180 milligram per deciliter, then the first important thing is to reduce the glucose infusion rate. In spite of progressively reducing the glucose infusion rate, and in spite of bringing it to minimal level, if the glucose level is still more than 180, if the repeated values are more than 180, then you have to treat with insulin. So another question is, when is the right time to start routine for extremely low birth weight babies? Should we start on day one? Should we start somewhere between day 3 to day 5? Or should we start anytime after the baby is stabilized, after the initial clinical course is stabilized? Or should we start between day 5 to day 7? So when is the ideal time?
Pooling, day one.
Okay, let us see what is the protein requirement in a preterm baby. You can see here a baby whose weight is somewhere between 500 to 700 gram, the protein requirement will be 4 gram per kg per day. As the weight increases, the protein requirement also gradually decreases. That means the protein requirement is inversely related to the birth weight and also the gestational age. So lower the gestational age, smaller the baby, more is the protein requirement. And this is the normal fetal tissue accretion. This is the data of a 26 to 28 week old baby and in utero life. In utero life, this baby will accrete a protein of around 2.2 gram per kg per day, lose around 0.2 gram in the skin from the dermal losses, and 1.1 gram through the urine. So the total protein requirement for this baby in utero life, somewhere around 26 to 28 week of gestation, is 3.5 gram per kg per day. So if we extrapolate the same data, we can see here the 3.5 gram per kg per day is the approximate protein requirement when we provide through TPN. The protein requirement will be slightly more when we give through enteral route because only 88% of the intestinal protein is absorbed. If you don't give protein, then extremely low birth weight neonates will lose up to 1.5 gram per kg per day of protein every day if the protein is not supplemented. So this is one important graph which you can see here. This orange color line indicates the in utero protein gain. That is, in the first 7 days of life, this is what happens in the in utero period. If you supplement the baby with 3 gram per kg per day, you may not achieve the in utero protein gain, but it will run parallel to the in utero protein gain, and there will be some positive protein balance in the body. And in the same baby, if you give 1 gram per kg per day, there is neither loss nor gain. The protein value in the body will be the same. But if you give only glucose to a neonate without providing protein, every day the baby will lose somewhere around 1.5 gram per kg per day. And by the end of 7 days, he would have lost up to 25% of his 25 gram of his body protein. So this is another important study by Thurin et al, which showed that if you give 1 gram per kg per day, there is net negative balance in the body. If you give at least 3 gram per kg per protein per day, if you account for amino acid intake and excretion, the total left, there will be some positive nitrogen balance or the positive protein in the body. So higher protein is recommended compared to the lower protein intake. But clinicians have many concerns. One of the commonest concerns which clinicians have is the increase in red urea nitrogen or increase in urea when we give excessive protein. Again, this study in Journal of Perinatology, which was published in Journal of Perinatology, showed that there is no statistical significant difference when you give a higher protein compared to a lower protein. Also, another important concern is the increase in ammonia levels. In this study, you can see here the ammonia levels. There is no significant difference between the groups when you supplement glutamine with respect to the control. And another important concern is the concern of metabolic acidosis when you give excessive protein. This is the table which shows randomized control trials of different studies. You can see here in all the studies, there is no significant differences with respect to two groups with regard to blood urea nitrogen, either ammonia or base excess. So the concern of metabolic acidosis will not be there even if we give a protein of around 3 g/kg/day. Studies by Thurin and Hay et al, which showed that even when they have compared 1 g versus 3 g, there is no difference between the groups with respect to blood urea nitrogen or base excess. And this is the cocaine meta-analysis, which compared higher amino acid intake with lower amino acid intake. If you see the overall effect size, it is favoring the higher amino acid group. It means the babies who received higher amino acids, they were discharged, sorry, the days to regain birth weight were 1.5 days earlier compared to the babies who were given lower amino acid intake. And again, another outcome which they saw was weight at discharge. The weight at discharge was 92 g more compared in the babies who received higher amino acid intake compared to the babies who received lower amino acid intake. Here you can see the diamond is favoring the higher amino acid intake. So in conclusion, it should be remembered that protein should be started early and you have to achieve the target levels early. Based on this this thing what we call the physiology, let us see what does the recommendation or guidelines say. NICE guidelines recommend that in the first 4 days, the protein requirement is should be somewhere around 1.5 to 2 gram per kg, and you gradually increase the protein requirement to 3 to 4 gram per kg per day. If you are starting TPN in a baby who is more than 4 days old, then you can directly start with 3 to 4 gram per kg per day. In case of term babies, in the first 4 days, you can start with 1 to 2 gram per kg per day and gradually increase to maintenance of somewhere between 2.5 to 3 gram per kg per day. ESPGAN guidelines also gives a similar recommendation. On day 1, you can start with 1.5 gram per kg per day and gradually increase to 2.5 to 3.5 gram per kg per day. In a term babies, ESPGAN recommends to start a protein somewhere between 1.5 to 3 gram per kg per day. So recommendation for our settings, you can start the protein with 2 gram per kg per day and gradually increase the maintenance to 3.4 to 4 gram per kg per day. Coming to the lipids, this is a graph which is showing the normal fat deposition in the third trimester among the different mammals, among human, guinea pig, rabbit, sheep and calf. You can see here, it is the human fetus which accumulates the maximum amount of fat in the third trimester. So, and this is also the graph which is showing the normal fetal mass accumulation. You can see here the fetal fat accumulation starts somewhere around 28 weeks and gradually increases to a maximum level of around 40 weeks. If you don't supplement the lipids, the babies will end up with essential fatty acids deficiency, and the protein catabolism will also happen if you don't give adequate lipids. So lipids are also essential for a preterm baby, and the most maximum fetal fat accretion happens in the third trimester. So this is the meta-analysis which showed whether the lipids are safe in the early first few days of life or not. In this meta-analysis, it was concluded that if you initiate the lipids within first 2 days of life, it was safe and it was a and the lipids were well tolerated. This was basically a safety and efficacy study. So based on this evidence, NICE guidelines recommend that in the first 4 days of life, you had to start somewhere between 1 to 2 g/kg/day and gradually increase every day by 0.5 to 1 gram to reach a maintenance dose of somewhere between 3 to 4 g/kg/day. If you're starting lipids for in a baby who is more than 4 days old, you can start with 3 to 4 g/kg/day. If the patient already has a parenteral nutrition associated liver disease, and if you are if you want to start TPN for that baby, NICE guidelines do not recommend to use the soy based lipid emulsions. They recommend composite lipid emulsion, that is a combination of different lipids. ESPGAN guidelines also gives similar recommendations. ESPGAN recommends to start lipids immediately after birth in preterm babies, not more than 2 days of life. The maximum recommendation they give is somewhere around 4 g/kg/day. So another question, which lipid formulation is currently recommended for TPN in neonates? Is it isolated fish oil, intralipid, any composite lipid emulsion is okay, or you don't know?
Fish oil recommended.
Let us see the different formulations of lipids which are available in the market. Intralipid contains 100% soybean oil. Lipofundin contains 50% of the soybean oil and 50% medium chain triglycerides. Lipoplus contains a combination of soybean, MCT oil and fish oil. SMOF, which is very commonly used in most of our NICUs, S stands for soybean, O for M for medium chain triglycerides, O for olive oil and F for fish oil. So it contains a different combination of these oils. Clinolic contains soybean and olive oil. Omega VIN is pure fish oil based lipid emulsion. So if you see the evidence, if you see the recent Cochrane review, and if you see the evidence which compared alternative lipid emulsions versus pure soy oil based lipid emulsions, there was no difference in death, BPD or parenteral nutrition associated liver disease between the two groups, and both the lipid emulsions were safe and they were well tolerated. So based on Espelin has given guidelines regarding type of lipid. One important thing is 20% lipid should be preferred compared to the 10% lipid if you're using an intralipid, because 20% lipid contains less phospholipids, less phospholipid to triglyceride ratio. If there are more phospholipids, then these phospholipids combine with cholesterol to form lipoprotein X, which results in increased free radical injury. So 20% lipid is always preferred compared to 10% lipid. How lipid infusion should be given? Should it be a continuous infusion or should you stop in between? Again, Espelin guidelines says continuous infusion is better compared to the intermittent infusion, because continuous infusion, the clearance of lipid will be better compared to intermittent infusion. Again, shielding from light, Espelin guidelines recommend that lipid should be covered with light. Espelin guidelines also recommends that if the patient is having unexplained thrombocytopenia and if you could not find any cause of, then they recommend everyday dose reduction of the lipids. So this is again another meta-analysis which compared fish oil based lipid emulsion with non-fish oil based lipid emulsion. Here you can see here in the studies where there was a low risk of bias, there was no statistical significant difference between the two groups. Whereas in the studies which had high risk of bias, they favored fish oil based lipid emulsions. Here the outcome was a development of disease, that is the cholestasis. So overall effect size is, if you see, it is favoring the fish oil based lipid emulsion. But since based on one study which dragged the diamond towards this side, and this study had a high risk of bias, so based on this the Cochrane review says that there is no particular lipid emulsion which is better than other, and they recommend further research is required to establish the role of fish liver oil in the parenteral nutrition associated liver disease. So if you are giving short term total parenteral nutrition, composite lipid is always better than soybean oil. Composite like SMOF, it is always better than soybean oil. This is the recommendation given by Espelin 2018, because here the primary outcome, this recommendation was based on the study where the outcome seen was not parenteral nutrition associated liver disease, but it was sepsis. The neonates who received composite lipid had less incidence of sepsis compared to the neonates who received soybean oil. So based on that meta-analysis, Espelin has recommended that composite lipid is better than soybean oil when you give short-term parenteral nutrition. And if you're giving long-term parenteral nutrition, you have to consider, again, you have to give composite lipid with or without fish oil. So recommendation for our settings, you can start lipid on day one. You can start with 1 to 2 gram per kg per day and gradually hike every day by 0.5 to 1 gram per kg per day. And you target a lipid intake of 3 to 4 gram per kg per day when you are giving the full TPN. Now another concept is the ratio of non-nitrogen energy to nitrogen. Non-nitrogen energy means the energy which is derived from carbohydrates and lipids, and nitrogen energy means the energy which is derived from the proteins. If the ratio is low, that is, if you are giving less carbohydrates and lipids and if you are giving more protein, then it may result in high blood urea even though it is very less and there is no protein left for tissue generation. What happens if you give high ratio? If you are giving high ratio means if you are giving more carbohydrates and lipids, then this may result in excessive fat deposition, it may result in hyperglycemia, it also results in hypertriglyceridemia. So it is very important to maintain a ratio of non-nitrogen energy to nitrogen. Let us see what does the evidence says. In NICE guidelines says you should give at least 20 to 30 kilocalorie of non-nitrogen energy per gram of amino acids. means for every 1 gram of protein, the energy from non-nitrogen sources, that is from carbohydrates and lipids, it should be 20 to 30 kilocalories. And the proportion of non-nitrogen energy is the carbohydrates should be 60 to 75% and lipids should be 25 to 40 within this ratio. Coming to the role of electrolytes, NICE guidelines do not give any recommendation for the dose of electrolytes. They tell the standard requirement for whatever is required for a preterm baby should be given. ESPGHAN guidelines recommend that electrolytes should be started during the initial body weight loss, that is during the contraction phase of the ECF, this thing. And sodium, the requirement should be somewhere between 2 to 5 millimole per kg per day. Potassium requirement should be 1 to 3 millimole per kg per day. So in conclusion, sodium and potassium you should ideally start during the phase of initial weight loss in neonates. That is from day 2 to day 3 onwards, you have to start sodium and potassium once the diuresis is established. Let us see the requirement of calcium in both the guidelines. NICE guidelines recommend initially in the first 1 to 2 days, 0.8 to 1 millimole per kg per day. And ESPGHAN guidelines also recommend a calcium intake of 0.8 to 2 millimole per kg per day. If you convert into milligram, it is 30 to 80 milligram per kg per day of calcium. And after day 2 onwards, both the guidelines recommend somewhere between 1.5 to 2 or 3.5 millimole per kg per day. That is 100 to 140 milligram per kg per day. Both the guidelines recommend to avoid calcium gluconate in total parental nutrition because of the aluminium toxicity, which is because of the aluminium contamination and aluminium toxicity in the glass vials, which is used to store the calcium gluconate. But in our settings, most of us do use calcium gluconate, and it should be used with a caution when you're using TPN. Coming to phosphate, both the guidelines recommend initial phosphate of 1 millimole per kg per day. And as you increase the TPN, it should increase to somewhere between 2 millimole per kg per day. For a growing preterm, it is 1.6 to 3.5 millimole per kg per day. If you convert into milligram, on first day, you have to start with 30 to 60 milligram per kg per day. And for a growing preterm, it should be 77 to 108 milligram per kg per day. Another important thing is, what should be the ratio of calcium to phosphate? Calcium phosphate molar ratio is, in a preterm and term babies, the ratio should be less than 1. According to NICE guidelines, they recommend up to 0.75 to 1. ESPGHAN guidelines also gives a similar recommendation, that is, the ratio of calcium to phosphate should be less than 1. This is because to prevent the early hypercalcemia and hypophosphatemia when you are giving total parental nutrition in the first few days of life. So to avoid hypercalcemia and hypophosphatemia, you have to give less calcium and more phosphate in the early TPN. Regarding the role of iron in total parental nutrition, both the guidelines do not recommend total and parental iron. Parental iron is only recommended if you are giving TPN for more than 3 weeks. Otherwise, iron is not recommended through the TPN. Regarding magnesium, NICE guidelines do not give any dose recommendation for the magnesium. They recommend that it should be started at the outset. ESPGHAN guidelines recommend again 0.1 to 0.2 millimole per kg initially and 0.2 to 3 millimole in a growing preterm. One important thing one should remember about magnesium is it should be started from day 1, and one should monitor the blood levels if there is a maternal exposure of magnesium. If the mother has received magnesium for neuroprotection for a preterm baby or for delaying the labor, then you have to monitor the blood levels. Regarding multivitamins in TPN, NICE guidelines recommend that you have to start from the outset, and both ESPGHAN guidelines also gives a similar recommendation that multivitamins should be started from the outset. And multivitamins should be always mixed in the lipid solution. Lipid solution, because the fat soluble vitamins are better dissolved in the lipid, and it also improves the stability. The multivitamins, again, mixing in the lipid solution prevents the peroxidation of multivitamins. One of the common multivitamin which is very prone for peroxidation is riboflavin. So when we mix with lipid solution and cover it, the chances of vitamin peroxidation is also very less. ESPGHAN guidelines give separate dose for preterm and term babies. This is the multivitamin recommendation by ESPGHAN guidelines. You can approximately give 1.5 ml per kg of common multivitamin solution which is available. It should not increase more than 4 ml or 5 ml per day. And it is always better to see the content in the multivitamin vial and should go according to the RDA which is required for a baby. Trace elements, both the guidelines recommend that you have to start trace elements at the outset as soon as the TPN is started. They do not give any specific recommendation for the dose, but they don't give any recommendation for the dose. But most of the neonatology textbook recommend that trace elements should be started after 2 weeks of TPN. If the baby is requiring to be a TPN for more than 2 weeks, then you have to start trace elements. The only trace element which needs to be started from the day one of life is zinc. But these two guidelines recommend that it should be started from the first day. Regarding the venous access in total parenteral nutrition, you can use either PICC line or a central venous line to give TPN. Umbilical vein can also be used if you are giving a short-term TPN. Use this line, the PICC line or central line, and this line should be used only for total parenteral nutrition. This line should not be used to give blood products, antibiotics, or any other thing. And this line should have a minimal ports to avoid the risk of infection. The catheter should ideally be made of silicone or polyurethane. Where should be the tip of central venous line when you give TPN? Should it be in right atrium or should it be in IVC or at least 0.5 centimeter above the carina?
IVC.
Okay, let us see what does the evidence say regarding the position of catheter tip. Catheter tip, if it is inside the heart, it increases the risk of pericardial effusion and also increases the risk of arrhythmias. The pericardial reflection in a baby in a neonate is 4 millimeter above and 5 millimeter below the carina. So based on this, the ESPEGAN guidelines 2018 recommend that the central venous catheter, that is, if you are using a central line, the tip should lie outside the pericardial sac. It should not be visible within the pericardial sac. And if you are using the central line in a small infant, that is, the body length what they are given is 47 to 57, that is approximately for a term baby. If you are using a subclavian or jugular, then the tip should be 0.5 centimeter above the carina on a chest X-ray. Let us see what are the interventions to reduce the catheter-related bloodstream infections. There is no role of routine change or replacement of catheter when you are giving tip PICC line when you are giving TPN, sorry, and there is no role of prophylactic antibiotics, and you should not reinsert the what you call same line with a new guide wire. And antibiotic locks also for reducing the catheter-related bloodstream infection is not recommended. Use of heparin to prevent occlusion is also not recommended by the ESPEGAN group. So this is the Cochrane review, which says that for using use of heparin for prolonging the peripheral intravenous catheter use. This is for peripheral intravenous catheter use. Again, they recommend that there is insufficient data and it should recommendations cannot be made. Coming to hygiene and antisepsis, most important thing when you give TPN is when you insert a central line before giving TPN is there should be appropriate hand hygiene. Hand hygiene with soap and water for at least 40 to 60 seconds should be strongly emphasized. And one should avoid chlorhexidine babies less than 2 months because of toxicity, because of absorption from the premature skin and also toxicity-related issues. Both the ESPEGAN guidelines and CDC guidelines recommend the same, that it should be avoided in less than 2 months. The catheter probes, the catheter connectors, the catheter ports, the catheter hubs, these are the gateway of infection. So these hubs and ports should be disinfected with chlorhexidine and alcohol. CDC guidelines recommend only alcohol for cleaning the ports and hubs. So before every access, this catheter hub should be cleaned properly. So this is the scrub the hub, this thing. If you scrub the hub for only 0 seconds, you can see here the particulate matter is still there. If you clean for 10 seconds, even for 10 seconds, still some amount of particulate matter is still present. If you scrub the hub for 15 seconds, then there is complete elimination of particulate matter, bacteria, and biofilms. So you have to scrub the catheter hub before every access with alcohol, or you can also add chlorhexidine, a combination of chlorhexidine or alcohol. CDC recommends only alcohol, or at least isopropyl alcohol for at least 15 seconds before every access into the catheter port. Regarding the catheter dressing, catheter site can be we can use either a sterile gauze or a transparent semi-permeable dressing for covering the catheter site, but always recommended is a transparent semi-permeable dressing. If there is a bleeding or oozing from the site of insertion of the catheter, then always use a sterile gauze. Do not use transparent semi-permeable dressing because the blood will soak inside that semi-permeable dressing. If you have used a sterile gauze to cover the area of insertion, then the sterile gauze should be changed every 2 days, once in every 2 days. And if you are using a transparent dressing, then the dressing should be changed once in every 7 days. You have to change the catheter dressing if it's dampened or loosened. There is no role of chlorhexidine impregnated dressing, means the soakage of chlorhexidine and keeping the gauze there. And topical antibiotics near the catheter site is also not recommended. Coming to the role of inline filters. Inline filters claim to be effective strategy for removal of bacteria, endotoxins and other particulate matters which are associated with IV therapy in adults. It is commonly used when we give TPN in the adults, and it has been increasingly used in pediatric total parenteral nutrition, and in neonates also some units do use. NICE guidelines do not give any recommendations for the use of inline filters, but ESPGHAN guidelines do recommend the use of filters. They recommend for if you are giving lipid emulsions, then inline filter of 1.2 to 1.5 micron should be used. And if you are using aqueous solutions, then the filter size should be 0.22 micrometer. Let us see what does the evidence says. This is the one of the Cochrane meta-analysis reviews which regarding the use of intravenous inline filters for preventing mortality and morbidity. In this review, you can see here there is no difference between the groups with respect to the mortality or morbidity. So for recommendations for our settings, there is uncertainty of benefit or harm, and because of the availability issues and many other things, we cannot recommend these to our setting currently. Do you cover TPN syringes or lines? Do you cover? Don't cover. You cover only lipids. You cover lipids, aminomin and glucose. Let us see what does the evidence says. The physiological rationale for covering the TPN solutions from light is that when you expose the TPN solutions to the light, there will be generation of peroxides. Peroxides creates oxidant stress to the baby, and light also increases the degradation of the vitamins, especially the riboflavin, and peroxide generation has also been implicated in the lipid intolerance. If you see this recent meta-analysis, which was published in 2017, where the outcome was mortality, here the babies whose TPN was covered with light, this LP is light protected, LE is light exposed, you can see the mortality was almost 50% less, that is almost 47% in the light protected group, almost less than half. So based on this meta-analysis, ESPGHAN guidelines recommend, and both ESPGHAN and NICE guidelines recommend, that bag syringes and infusion sets of both aqueous and lipid parenteral nutrition should be protected from light. Whereas ESPGHAN guidelines recommends only it should be covered only for a TPN use in preterm neonates. So for our settings, you have to cover at least lipid solutions, especially in a preterm babies. Coming to the monitoring in total parenteral nutrition, blood glucose you have to monitor every 1 to 2 hours after starting the total parenteral nutrition or change of TPN, but at least you have to monitor at least 3 times a day. Once the baby is stable, then you can do once a day. Blood pH, potassium, chloride, calcium, phosphate, you should monitor every 24 hourly when you start the TPN, then once in a week or twice a week. Serum triglycerides you have to monitor when you're increasing the dose, that is once in 24 hours. Once the baby is stabilized, then you can monitor once a week. Both the guidelines recommend monitoring of triglycerides once a week, but when you are increasing the dose or when you're starting the TPN, you have to monitor every 24 hourly. If the triglyceride concentration is more than 265, then you have to reduce the dose of intralipid. Liver function test you have to monitor weekly, initially before starting TPN and then once a week. ESPGHAN guidelines recommend that you have to monitor after 2 weeks after initiation. Blood urea nitrogen and creatinine, also again the same thing, you have to monitor once weekly, and ESPGHAN guidelines says as it is required. Iron status, you don't monitor iron in a baby who is receiving TPN. Only those babies who are on long-term TPN for more than 28 days, in them the iron status should also be monitored. When should we stop TPN? NICE guidelines recommend in newborns less than 28 weeks of gestation, you have to stop once the enteral feeds of 140 to 150 ml per kg per day is attained. In a newborn who is more than 28 weeks, you can stop once the feed of 120 to 140, that is earlier. ESPGHAN guidelines do not give any specific recommendations for stopping the TPN and increasing the feeds. They recommend that one always start fits along with TPN and gradually increase the fits and come down on the TPN. They don't give any specific guidelines as such when we should stop. But most of the units stop lipids once a feed of 60 to 80 ml per kg per day is reached, because by this time most of the essential fatty acid requirement is met through the enteral feeding. And proteins you can stop once you reach a feed of 100 to 120 ml per kg per day. So the take home message is you have to start parenteral nutrition early in all eligible units. You start feeds as soon as possible if there are no contraindications. Maintain strict taste sepsis when you give TPN and also good infection control measures. Develop individualized unit protocol and you have to follow them strictly.
There seems to be some questions in the chat box. Do you want to have a look, please?
Where, sir?
In the chat.
So the first question is, can you hear me, Pratik?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The first question is there any recommendation for lipids in critically ill neonates?
Critically ill neonates, critically ill neonates also you can start the lipids with at least minimal lipid to prevent the fatty acid deficiency, essential fatty acid deficiency. You can start somewhere around 0.5 to 1 gram per kg per day. You can continue that, at least 0.5 to 1 gram per kg per day. There is no need to stop the lipids even in such babies. Otherwise, they will end up with essential fatty acid deficiencies.
This is by Dr. Sharat Chandra. Is asking the availability of SMOF in India.
SMOF, I'm not sure. We are still using it. I think it is available.
It is available, actually. We can use it in our.
It is available. It is available. SMOF is available.
I have a few questions, Pratik. One is if you are inserting the central venous catheter from the leg, actually. What should be the position of that catheter?
So the standard guidelines recommend that if you are inserting from a leg, from